We'll start with this news. Marcus Johansson signed a 2-year, $9 million contract with the Buffalo Sabres. Over the weekend on Saturday, Johansson had 30 points last year with the Bruins and the Devils and finished with 11 points in 22 playoff games for Boston. EJ, do you like the fit here, Marcus Johansson in Buffalo?
Well, it's a great signing, I think, for the Buffalo Sabres to get a player of Johansson's ilk on a nice term and dollar amount. I mean, I'm surprised that there wasn't another team that would come along and wanted to maybe give him an extra year or two, maybe even a little bit more money. But for the Buffalo Sabres, it's a terrific contract, and it's adding a player that has been in winning situations over the last several years in his contract or in his career, previously with the Washington Capitals, last year going to the final with the Boston Bruins. So for me, JMO, the Buffalo Sabres are looking to add good players to their team. I mean, that's the bottom line. They're looking to add good players throughout their lineup because this is a team that's still trying to get better. And Marcus Johansson is a versatile guy. He's a terrific top nine forward. He can play in all kinds of different spots within your team. He's a smart player, helps you on the power play, can probably kill some penalties for you as well. So for me, I think it's a great signing for the Sabres.
All right, you can see his numbers here in the Stanley Cup playoffs. In those 22 games, had 11 points. And Mike Rupp said multiple times he was the Boston Bruins' top forward during that Stanley Cup final against the St. Louis Blues. From a Bruin to a Sabre, here's Johansson on that transition.
I like what Buffalo's got going. I think talking to Ralph, he has some really good ideas on how to play, and it's a really young and exciting team, so I'm looking forward to it. And
with all these young players being so good, they learn from everything, and I think that with all the talent they have and the skill that the Buffalo have with Jack Eichel and Skinner, and then even on defense with Rasmus Dahlin and all those guys, I think it's gonna go well. Whatever they need me to do, I'm up for it. I think that's why everyone comes to play. You want to help the team win, and that's my main focus. And if it's at center, it is. And if it's at left wing, I'm happy to do both. Once I come down to it, I was really happy that I ended up going to Buffalo.
All right, Johansson to Buffalo, just one of the latest moves. They've been busy, certainly this summer. You can see their timeline. April 7th, Phil Housley fired as the head coach after missing the playoffs in both seasons behind the bench. May 15th, Ralph Krueger hired as the head coach, 19th head coach in franchise history. Fast forward to June 7th, Jeff Skinner. That was priority number one this offseason. They re-signed him. 8 years, $72 million, coming off a career-high 40 goals last season. From June 7th to June 21st, Dylan Cousins drafted 7th overall, and Ryan Johnson drafted 31st overall, the two top picks for Buffalo at the draft in Vancouver. June 28th, Colin Miller acquired in a trade from the Vegas Golden Knights for a 2021 second rounder and a 2022 fifth round pick. From June 28th to July 1, free agency. Jimmy Vesey acquired in a trade from the Rangers for a third round pick in 2021. And July 6th, over the weekend, Marcus Johansson signing as a UFA from the Bruins on a 2-year deal worth $9 million, AAV of 4.5. So you look at Buffalo prior to that timeline, and you look at the Buffalo Sabres now, how much of an improved team are they in your opinion?
Well, I think they're a better team. I think when you think about their top nine now, they've added Vesey and they've added Johansson as legitimate NHL top nine forwards to their group. Versatile guys, smart players, can help you in a lot of different ways. I think Jimmy Vesey, I think maybe he'll have an opportunity now to move his career to another level. I don't think it just didn't really happen as maybe he anticipated with the New York Rangers. But, the guy up there that you really got to keep an eye on is that number 37, the second center spot there, Casey Mittelstadt, because this is a really talented young player. He was a high draft pick. He's a young guy. Is he ready to take a step next year and be more productive in the Buffalo Sabres lineup? That's the question for me. If he is, those players around him, like a Johansson and a Vesey that they brought in, all of a sudden those guys have more value. Maybe they will help push Mittelstadt to that next level. But it is early in his career, and he needs time to develop.
All right, so Buffalo looking better on paper, at least at this point, but so does the other teams in their division, the Atlantic Division. What is the ceiling for the Buffalo Sabres coming up next season?
Well, it's going to be an interesting year for the Buffalo Sabres. I think that they're better. Certainly, I think their top nine is better. The moves they made on defense added Miller. They've brought in Montour last season from the Ducks. There's been a lot of talk about them trading Ristolainen. I mean, that right side, when you think about Ristolainen, Montour, Miller, and they have Zach Bogosian, who's hurt. He'll miss the start of the season at hip surgery. Who knows? He's the guy that's been dinged up a lot. They've got Rasmus Dahlin on the left side with McCabe, Jake McCabe, and they have Matty Hunwick, Marco Scandella as a couple left shot guys too. I think that they're looking at being a bubble team, has a chance to maybe qualify for the postseason, but it's going to be difficult because the division they're in, Tampa Bay, Boston, Toronto, Florida made all the moves they made. You know they're going to be better. The Montreal Canadiens, I think that's a team that could grow on what they did last year. So for me, it's going to be a challenge for the Buffalo Sabres. I think job one for Ralph Kruger coming in. Remember, Kruger has not coached in the National Hockey League in 6 years. Heck, he hasn't been even involved with hockey. He's been involved with European soccer, with the exception of coaching Team Europe at the World Cup of Hockey, and that team did do well in that short tournament that took place a couple of years back. But Ralph Kruger is going to have to come in, and they are going to have to change the culture there. There has to be accountability on this team night after night after night. We saw last year they had a good start. They had a really, really great run in November, and then it all fell apart. I think the top nine is better and more versatile. The younger players need to step up. Eichel needs to take another step as well. I like the group of defensemen. I wouldn't trade Rasmus Ristolainen unless they have a really good offer for him. And then what's going to happen in goal? Because that's the biggest question. I mean, Carter Hutton and Linus Ullmark last year, they're the numbers. They're okay. But they have to be better, and the Buffalo Sabres have to have structure, and they have to have accountability within their group. So for me, that's really the biggest thing in Buffalo for a team that's been on the outside looking in for so long. You have to change the culture. The players in that room have to be accountable to one another. They have to have a system in place there. And then they're going to have to play better in front of their goalies. And when called upon, Hutton and Ullmark are going to have to step up and play well.
We joked. We don't know how it's going to play out on the ice. But that pregame soccer match, it might be the best team in the league.
There you go. Could
based
be.
On Ralph Kruger's English
Premier League. I like Ralph Kruger a lot, though. Yeah. I like him. He's an interesting guy. I thought he didn't get a fair shake with the Edmonton Oilers. They only had a half season there before he was let go. He went over to do the soccer gig overseas, but I think he has a chance to be a very good coach in this league. But it's going to take some work, and they've got to change the culture there. And that starts really from the ownership all the way down. You know, I think the Pegula family has done so much in Buffalo, and they really want this team to have success. But at some point in time, that has to grow from within the group, the manager, Jason Botterill, the head coach. They've got to make this thing work in that room. And so far, it just hasn't happened over the last couple of years.
All right. Buffalo Sabres missing the eighth and final playoff spot in the East by 22 points last year.
It's going to be a challenge.
Yeah. At one point this year, they were the top team in the East. And then all of a sudden, the wheels, the wagon, and the axles and everything.
The Blues and the Sabres went in different directions.
Flip-flop. Going in different directions, the Boston Bruins. So Marcus Johansson, their loss, Buffalo's game. How big of a loss is this for the Boston Bruins that depth up front?
It's a loss, but he's not a core player for the Boston Bruins. I mean, the core of their team is still through the middle with Bergeron and Krejci there, Marchand on the wing, Pasternak. I mean, those are the key guys. They're hoping to get more out of DeBrusk. They got to figure out what they're going to do contract-wise with Danton Heinen. They still have Charlie Coyle there, so they'll miss him. But the thing they can do is as they did this past season. When we get to the trade deadline, if the Bruins are in a position to be successful again in the postseason, they can go out and add a player of that ilk to their group for a playoff run. So we'll see how things go during the year. But they got some contracts to figure out yet. They've got to get Charlie McAvoy done. They've got to get Brandon Carlo done, and Danton Heinen as well. And I think they have about $10, $11 million to work with. So that's going to be a little bit of a challenge for Don Sweeney.
Yeah, and this is a team that the last couple of years has relied on some of the youth stepping up, and they've done that so far historically.
One other note about Sebastian Aho, he can control the game.
Aho's on it, he scores!
Tremendous skater, he's got tremendous vision on the ice.
And he's been fantastic, he's been leading that charge.
This is where legends are made.
That's what they wanted! One-timer in, it's Aho!
Hey, what do you say? Patrick Sebastian Aho!
Through center ice, Aho, partial two on one,
his shot scores!
Vachon, who's had a terrific year.
Sebastian Aho had his five-year, $42.27 million offer sheet matched by the Carolina Hurricanes on Sunday. The 21-year-old forward was a RFA and was tendered the offer sheet, which had an AAV of $8.45 million by the Habs on July 1. But as you can see, he is staying put in Raleigh, North Carolina for the next foreseeable future. You can see the contract breakdown here. July 1 signed that offer sheet with Montreal, 5 years, $42.27 million. July 7th, the Hurricanes match it. That'll be largest cap hit on Carolina for the upcoming season. Combined signing bonus and base salary, $22.57 mil in the first two seasons. That's more than half the contract. Wish we had signing bonuses like that here at the NHL Network.
That would be quite lovely.
Not the case for us, but certainly a positive case for Sebastian Aho. Better fit for him to stay put, do you think, where he's at in his career and just the comfort level that he has there in Raleigh with him and his teammates?
I could see him being a fit in either Montreal or Carolina. That's obviously what Mark Bergevin felt as well, because he went out and went through with this process. I don't think the Montreal Canadiens got both feet into the water, though. I think they would have needed to. Aside from front-loading it and making it hard from a dollar standpoint for Tom Dundon and the Carolina Hurricanes in the first 2 years, I think they didn't go to the level financially that would make it more of a problem for the Canes and would cost the Montreal Canadiens more in compensation. They stopped short of that. It was
just short
of that, right? Intentionally, with a first, a second, and a third round pick. I don't think anybody would trade a first, a second, and a third. I don't think the Carolina Hurricanes would accept that as trade for Sebastian Aho, particularly a Canadian team. I mean, let's face it, they could have, let's say, the 23rd pick in the first round. So now you're looking at 23, 46, and 80 or something like that. So I think the Montreal Canadiens needed to go further if they were going to actually get the player. They didn't. Carolina matched. And it'll be a dollar's hardship early on to pay them all that money. But at the end of the day, after they pay them all that money the first 2 years, they're not paying them a heck of a lot for the rest of the contract. When you think about it, they're paying a lot of that money up front. And so it'll all come out in the wash. The cap hit, I think, is good. And Donnie Woodell said it best. I thought the offer sheet would be worth more. So I think for the Carolina Hurricanes and for their fans, they put this behind them. And the great news is that their player, who's an RFA, we're just talking about all these RFA players around the league. He is signed. He'll be the first day of training camp. He won't miss any time. It's all done and over with. So the Carolina Hurricanes are probably happy that even though they didn't maybe want to pay out the structure the way the structure is, they knew this is what it was going to take. They've got their best player back at the top of their lineup.
How important was it for this team to kind of maintain that momentum they had built from this past season with the storm surge and everything Justin Williams did and making the playoffs and just the energy and excitement in that area for hockey right now to maintain and keep their main guy locked up?
Critical. It was critical. This is a team that missed the playoffs for many, many years in a row. They have all that excitement, all that energy. They need to keep moving forward, and you can't do that when you lose your best player to an offer sheet. I talked about it on July 1st. It reminded me a lot of the situation in Nashville when the Philadelphia Flyers came knocking with the big offer sheet for Shea Weber. That took several days for the Predators to kind of decide what they were going to do. In the end, they matched. I thought at the time they had to, and I thought the same was the case for the Carolina Hurricanes. In this particular case, the offer sheet, while being front-loaded, wasn't that difficult for them to match. So, for me, it was critical that they did. And that's exactly what ownership and management did. They stepped up and matched.
We were hoping for offer sheets on July 1. We got a match.
And yeah.
Sebastian Aho.
That's why we don't get that many, because most
Carolina.
Of the time
exactly.
they get matched.
It was fun. Speaking of guys re-signing, how about Kevin LeBanc in the San Jose Sharks? One-year contract to stay in San Jose. That deal coming out on Monday. The 23-year-old forward. He had an NHL career high in goals, 17, assists, 39, and points, 56, in 82 regular season games with the Sharks this past year. Reportedly, the contract, 1 year, $1 million. That seems very team-friendly for a guy that put up 56 points, $1 million bucks each.
Yeah, I would say team-friendly is an understatement.
Yeah.
I mean, 56 points and a one-year, $1 million contract, that is a favor that Kevin LeBanc is doing with the San Jose Sharks and for that organization. Hopefully that will be repaid down the road. I'm sure they've had discussions about what the future holds in San Jose for Kevin LeBanc. But the reality is this. He has to go out and produce now. There's no guarantee.
Right. There's that, no scratch my you're back, I'll get, scratch yours.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, if you go out and put up 12 points this year, you know, you're not going to get any kind of big raise off that. So it's kind of mind-boggling that he had 56 points this year. He signs the one-year deal. The good news for LeBanc is now that he'll be ARB eligible next year. So if he has a similar year this year, he could go to ARB and really have the hammer in his hand and really get a substantial raise. But he is doing the San Jose Sharks quite a favor by signing a one-year, $1 million contract. This is a team that's up against it cap-wise, and they're going to need these kind of favors from the players within their group. And the guy right there in yellow, Joe Thornton, I'll be interested to see what his contract is going to look like, because the Sharks don't have a lot of room to play with.
It is the summer of the RFAs, or at least it feels that way. We still have some big names yet to sign contracts. None bigger than Mitch Marner, 22. This guy is going to make a whole lot more than $894,000 coming up. Braden Point just as big. And like you said, Tampa always seems to kind of figure it out. They've got some cap relief coming up with the injury to Ryan Callahan, long-term IR and whatnot. And Mikko Rantanen, of course, Colorado would like to extend him moving forward. Let's go Mikko Rantanen. Kind of a breakout season for this guy a year ago, that top line for Colorado. Is this a situation where you think Joe Sakic's kind of waiting to see what Mitch Marner signs for to kind of set the market on the other guys under there, including Mikko Rantanen?
There's probably a little of that involved here with Rantanen. I mean, there's no question he's a very high-end player, a big-bodied guy, smart player, plays in all kinds of situations. A great fit with Nathan MacKinnon in Denver right now. So, I mean, he is going to get paid, and they have the cap space to make it happen. They've got to look at the big picture, because they have a lot of younger players there that project to be really high-dollar players. Nathan MacKinnon is signed for, I think it's 4 more years, so that's
Might
a nice,
be
that's
best,
a really...
Best team-friendly deal
that's
in the league.
A nice deal right now to have, but at some point that will expire as well, and you have to try to manage how are things going to be internally there if you pay Rantanen a lot more than you're paying Nathan MacKinnon right now. So I think Joe Sakic, the assistant GM there, Chris McFarland, that whole group in Denver, they'll do the work, and he is somebody they certainly are going to sign. And the good news is they have a lot of cap space, so they'll be able to get it done. It's just a matter, again, as always, of term and dollars. Do they want to go in on that 8-year deal and lock this guy up for a long time? And if they're able to do that, you're buying unrestricted years. How much will that cost you? So it'll be curious which route they decide to go. And what does the player want to do? Maybe Rantanen decides, hey, you know what? I'd like to have a shorter-term deal. I'd like to have a 3-year deal, because you know what? I think I'm going to be really good in these next 3 years.
Bet on yourself.
And I want another kick at the can down the road. So that will be the back and forth between the player and management. And I'm sure it'll be an expensive one way or the other.
Exactly. Yeah. You talk to a lot of players and you talk to a lot of GMs. Do you come across a situation where guys like MacKinnon, who at the time signed a deal, and now it's like, whoa, that is, he's well underpaid. Do guys kind of get a little territorial about, hey, I'm worth way more than this guy, yet I signed a couple of years ago?
I think that's an individual thing that each player probably feels differently about. But in the end, this is a business. These guys understand how it goes. And for Nathan MacKinnon, he was thrilled to get the contract that he got a couple of years ago. Now, he's outperformed it, so that's a little bit of a negative maybe in his mind. But I think that Nathan MacKinnon, really what we've seen with him is he's about winning right now.
Yeah.
He has really matured into a great player and a leader in that team. And I think he's about winning. And I think all these players really, at the end of the day, it's about winning. And MacKinnon will get another crack at it, because his contract will expire if he continues to play well. Who knows where contracts and the money will be at that point in time. But for now, the Avalanche are positioned really well to make a push. And one other thing about players and money, there was one player in the league that's one of the top paid players in the league, and his team was struggling a little bit. He went to his general manager and asked him, I'd like to renegotiate down to create some space to go and get some other players to help our team. And the manager had to inform the player, we can't do that in this
league.
It's not something we can do. We appreciate you thinking of the group, but that gives you the mindset of some of these guys. Most of these guys, it's about winning. They are making a lot of money. Some of them could be making more. But, you know, at the end of the day, I think these high-end players, they're looking, especially in McKinnon, he's looking to win now. Yeah. He's looking to take that next step.
It's kind of the Tom Brady mentality. I know that's not your team, but yeah, there's only so much of the pie to go around.
Right.
And it helps when your wife makes $100 million a year.
That doesn't hurt.
The hockey world loves a game seven. May their best team win.
Feel the tension. This is why you play.
Stanley Cup's in the building. Someone's winning it.
One more for the Stanley Cup.
Score! The Blues have scored first in game seven.
Well, that was the moment they won the Stanley Cup, and this summer they've been taking it literally everywhere. A trio of Blues, Bozak, Shen, and Schwartz, trying to fire up the CFL crowd there, the Saskatchewan Rough Riders game. Oh, how about that jersey reveal, huh? Look at these guys.
Oh, boy.
A couple of Saskatchewan natives right there.
That's a fun summer.
Yeah. Right there, absolutely, right? Short but sweet. In a good kind of way. Speaking of sweet, Zach Sanford agreeing to terms on a two-year, $3 million contract with the Blues on Monday. The contract has an AAV of $1.5 million and allows the 24-year-old forward to avoid arbitration. Zach Sanford, of course, coming in clutch, entering the lineup in the middle of the Stanley Cup Final, and he played a big role for the St. Louis Blues. So take a look at some of the other guys that need to file to avoid arbitration. Jordan Binnington may be the most important on this list. You know what this kid did.
Yeah, he is. He is the most important on that list. I can be very clear on that.
Oscar Sundquist, Joel Edmondson, the others. Jordan Binnington, do you think he's going to go to arbitration? Or do you think both sides will kind of iron out a deal before they get to that meeting?
That's a great question, because it is an interesting negotiation, because Jordan Binnington doesn't have a big track record outside of half a season in the National Hockey League and what he did in the postseason, which is pretty substantial. What he did in the postseason, really, in my mind, should have been the Conn Smythe Trophy winner. Not taking anything away from Ryan O'Reilly, but I just thought Binnington was the guy that should have won that award. He was the difference maker for this team, gave him every opportunity to get better in the regular season, get to the playoffs in the first place. And then he always found a way to make the big save, and particularly in Game 7, the first period against the Boston Bruins, he was just lights out. So it's an interesting negotiation. The former Blues goaltender Mike Liut is the agent for Jordan Binnington. He's a goaltender. He knows this market very well. Doug Armstrong has been around for a long time, the manager of the St. Louis Blues. So I'm sure they'll try to work something out prior to arbitration. But going to arbitration might not be the worst thing for the St. Louis Blues in terms of a short-term deal that gets them through the now, and they can continue to discuss what they think about long-term and see a little bit more from Jordan Binnington. The only negative is that if he continues to play very well, all of a sudden the value goes up and he gets those unrestricted years, it could be very difficult then to resign him, but or become more challenging. Mm-hmm. But you have two veteran groups here. Again, that Liut camp, Mike Liut's been doing this for a long time on the agent side, and Doug Armstrong's been negotiating contracts in the National Hockey League, you know, going back for more than 20 years now. So at some point, I think they will get something done, but it'll be interesting how it happens, whether it goes through the arbitration process or whether they can come to a longer-term agreement without that.
And like you said earlier, one of the benefits of arbitration is that a contract gets done, and then you can focus on maybe the longer-term plan going forward.
Yes.
What do you think the plan is with Pat Maroon? It was such a great story, taking less money, betting on himself, coming back home. Maybe the regular season didn't play out how he wanted, but he was the hometown hero, scoring that double overtime game winner, Game 7 against Dallas, to send him to the Western Conference Finals, and obviously winning a Stanley Cup and having his son on the ice, and it seems like both sides can't really come to an agreement right
now. Yeah, I think it's more the St. Louis Blues have just decided that, you know, that was a one-and-done type situation. Patrick Maroon is a big, burly player in a league that has really gone to more speed. Now, he was a great fit on that line with Robert Thomas and Tyler Bozak, but you can see the numbers here. Not big, big-time numbers, although important guy in the room. I think there is a contract out there for Pat Maroon with perhaps another team. I think if I was talking as his agent to the Blues, I would try to sell the Blues on a lower salary on a longer term, maybe, you know, a 1.2 over 2 or 3 years because of the local factor and because he is a player in certain parts of the season and in particular games that can be really helpful for you, despite the fact that he isn't the big speedy forward. He's someone that does bring that size and strength around the net. So I get the sense, based on what I've heard, that that he is probably going to have to go elsewhere. We'll see if it plays out that way. But it was a season to remember for Patrick Maroon to go back to your hometown and to win the Stanley Cup, the first in franchise history. I hope something can get worked out, but it just it seems like it's going in another direction.
Yeah, well, if we've learned anything from the last two Stanley Cup champions, Washington Capitals, St. Louis Blues, it's regular season speed and skill, but come playoff time, there's still that, need.
Toughness,
exactly, size and strength and wearing teams down over the course of a 7-game series. All right, still a few pieces to iron out between now and October. You can see some of the Flames' notable RFAs right now. Matthew Tkachuk about to get paid this summer. You can see he's 21 as of October 2nd, coming off that cap hit of $925,000, the entry-level contract. Speaking of goaltenders, we talked about Cam Talbot, that signing. How about David Riddick coming off a good season up there in Calgary? 27 years old, cap hit of $800,000. Sam Bennett, Andrew Mangiapane, and Ryan Lomberg as well. Some of the guys that they still have to iron out deals with moving forward. For more on the Flames, we welcome in Flames host on Sportsnet, Ryan Leslie, to the show right now. Ryan, what is the latest with Matthew Tkachuk in that RFA contract situation?
He was just in town, actually. He took part in the Calgary Stampede, the greatest outdoor show on earth. He was riding a horse and really embracing it, which was a neat sign because, obviously, he is a very big part of this organization. And I can tell you that the discussions are routine and very positive and with some real regularity. Brad Treliving, the Flames general manager, and, of course, the Tkachuk camp have an ongoing dialogue. Nothing to really worry about as I talk to both sides. It just remains, I think pretty much on the right pace. And I know there's some discussion about other RFAs and what that's going to mean and that impact that it might, may or may not have on Matthew. It remains to be seen. But this is a player who remains very much engaged in the entire process with the organization and obviously his agent.
Ryan, what can you tell us about possible trade rumors we're hearing about a TJ Brody or a Travis Hamonic? Because it seems like their names have been in the mix. Are these guys that the Flames are maybe looking to move out with just 1 year left on each of their contracts?
Well, I think that's it, isn't it, guys? Because I think sort of jump to that when it is a player's final year of a contract and you start to think about how good they are and you can see the numbers for both. Let's keep in mind both players had really good seasons and bounce back seasons. And TJ Brody was a fourth round pick a number of years ago. He has just come on as a number one part of that pairing with Giordano, 24 minutes or so a night, and he really did bounce back. Travis Hamonic, Brad Treliving gave up a first rounder and 2 second rounders to get him. Very integral parts of that blue line, both really good. And probably no surprise, I think everybody heard about a report out of Toronto that had Brody as part of the Kadri situation. That Kadri situation really started when their regular season came to an end a little too early. And there was obviously some reports out there that those players were going to be linked. Those discussions, I can tell you, never went as far as maybe that report would indicate. And I think we all know that a lot of these trade conversations take place and dissolve with some regularity as well, too. So when we start to hear about them, we blow them up a little bit. But that one, there were some discussions about it. I would be very surprised, on the Hamonic front, if that ever were to happen. I think TJ Brody is a player that a couple of teams covet. Makes a lot of sense. Both players are players that other teams would covet. But I really think that at this point, it would be a surprise if a guy like Travis Hamonic were involved at this point, and I'd be really surprised about TJ Brody in the end when it's all said and done. I would be very surprised if you didn't see them both with the Flaming C this year.
All right, we talked about the acquisition of goaltender Cam Talbot. How do the Flames feel about their goaltending tandem with Talbot and David Rittich maybe splitting time next season?
Yeah, I think they're really comfortable and confident in it. Brad Treliving and Bill Peters both have a little history with Cam Talbot going on the international stage. And David Rittich really turned a lot of heads, and you can see the numbers, how good they are. And this is a player who still has to get paid, still has to get a new contract. But in terms of what they have, a 1A, 1B, a lot of confidence as they had to say goodbye to a guy like Mike Smith. But now David Rittich can kind of be that guy with some real healthy competition. It seems like that's what this thing is. And I think they want to see what Rittich is and can still be capable of after a really good year. I think Talbot seems to be a real competitive and complementary piece for their goaltending situation. It's going to be fun. I mean, I know Treliving has mentioned publicly that, you know, he still thinks that they can get a little bit more. Here we are talking about bounce back seasons. They think they can get him back to where he was early on in his career.
Ryan, let me ask you about the situation with James Neal. He was signed to a five-year contract last offseason. It did not work out last year. Really not a good year for him. Is there any way they can move this contract, $5.75 million against the cap? Is there anything they can do with that, or are they just going to hope he can come to camp and get himself going?
Geez, this seems to be the theme, doesn't it, to the bounce back. If they ever needed a guy to turn things around right now, it would be James Neal. It did not go well, as you say. And to be honest, I don't know personally how many teams are lined up for the services of James Neal at this point. Now, this is a proud player. This is a player who's had success. He's used to it. And I know he was very angry and did not hide from the discussion at the end of the year when the heat was on. And he was a healthy scratch in that final game in the postseason. And now it's on himself, and he's owned it. I want to see if he's got the legs still. I want to see if he's got that ability to kind of turn things around, because that is a hefty contract. And that is a player who's, you know, got to find and find some speed in his game, or rediscover rather that scoring touch, because it was non-existent. He did not duck the media throughout the season. It was hard on him. And he's, as I say, a proud veteran who is used to having some success. I'm really curious to see what he does this offseason that helps him bounce back in the fall.
Yeah, we'll see if the real deal can reinvent himself next season, coming up in a Flame sweater. Ryan, thank you so much. Enjoy the summer or what's left of it, and we'll talk to you again, I'm sure, down the road at some point next year.
Appreciate it. Thanks for having me, guys.
All right, Ryan Leslie covers the Flames on a regular basis for Sportsnet up north in Canada. When you look at the Flames and what they are on paper right now in July, have they gotten better, in your opinion?
Well, that's a great question, because they moved Mike Smith out. They added Cam Talbot in. They still are going to rely on David Rittich, and I think they're going to really give David Rittich a lot more room to roll this year in that crease for the Calgary Flames. They're hoping, as Ryan said, that you know, Cam Talbot can rediscover that kind of game that he had a couple of years back when he helped the Edmonton Oilers make the postseason. But you know, I'm not so sure that that is going to happen. It's going to have to be, I think, a kind of combination of the two goalies to make things work for the Calgary Flames. And I don't think they're tinkering with their roster yet, because Brody and you know, and Hamonic, they are both going into the final year of their contract. They've got other contracts they have to take care of. I think general manager Brad Treliving would move one or both of those guys in the right deal. I think they're very disappointed about the way the team played in the postseason. They had a really good regular season, and then if it weren't for a great effort by Mike Smith in game number one of that series against the Colorado Avalanche, they probably would have been swept. Yeah. So really, I think that they're really taking a hard look at that roster right now, and they've got to hope that you can either move James Neal out of there, and they would have to retain a lot of salary to do so, or he comes in and starts playing well, and then they could maybe figure something out down the road. But there's some challenges there for the Calgary Flames.
Oh, we asked him about the Matthew Tkachuk contract situation right now. Do you think not only his contract situation, but a whole bunch of these RFAs out there just kind of clogged up right now, everybody waiting to see what Mitch Marner does, and that maybe kind of sets the market?
I think that that's part of it. I think that that is certainly part of it. Marner is the big fish, and he is in Toronto. And I think people are waiting to see what happens with Mitch Marner. I think it's holding up some trades as well, and what other teams are trying to do, and certainly what's going on in that RFA market when you think of, a Braden Point, who I think will stay in Tampa. There were some reports that the Montreal Canadiens, David Pagnotta from the Fourth Period, reported that the Canadiens wanted to throw an offer sheet at Point, and he decided he wasn't interested in that. Tampa Bay Lightning have a history of getting their players signed, so I suspect he'll sign there. But even that deal, I think they're waiting to see what's going to happen with Mitch Marner. So all of them are individual with their different circumstances, different markets, different cap circumstances involved. But I do think that the Marner contract is kind of one of those things that some of the agents want to see how that plays out.
Yeah, we want to see how it plays out. Once that first domino falls, then we have news for the rest of the summer, or so it seems.
Sure.
Welcome back to NHL Tonight. Our good friend and former colleague Brian Boucher reminding us about the 1995 NHL entry draft. Flashback to July 8th, 1995, a day that changed my life forever.
Young Boosh.
Still has the same hair, though, right?
Still, guys, still great, looking good.
Great salad on top.
No doubt.
Of that.
No doubt.
Right there. So we look back on the 1995 NHL draft, taking a look at the top 10 picks. Brian Berard, the first overall pick, followed by Wade Redden. Aki Berg went third overall to the LA Kings. Chad Kilger, third to the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. Damon Lenkow to the Tampa Bay Lightning. Steve Kelly, Shane Doan, Terry Ryan, he went eighth to Montreal. Kyle McLaren, the big defenseman, went ninth to the Boston Bruins. And rounding out the top 10, Radek Dvorak, 10th overall to the Florida Panthers. It is always fun to spin it forward and do the redraft, the Monday morning quarterback, if you will. So if you had the chance to redraft 1995, how would it look? Start us 10 through 6.
Yeah, well, we have a lot of evidence, right? Because these careers are all over, so it's easy to take a look at, right? I would have Brian Berard 10th. I mean, somebody might say, well, it wasn't that great a career. It wasn't because of a significant eye injury. It was the rookie of the year in 97 and still ended up with scoring more than 0.5 points per game in his career. So he'd be 10. Sammy Kapanen, terrific year over a long time with the Hartford Whalers, Carolina Hurricanes, Philadelphia Flyers, 5 20-goal seasons. Damon Lenkow, really an underrated player when you look at the numbers. Over 1,000 games in his career, 7 times a 20-goal scorer. He had 2 30-goal seasons with the then Phoenix Coyotes. Wade Redden, some might want him higher up. He was a really high-end defenseman for a good chunk of his career. In 05-06, 50 points, a plus 35. And then Peter Sikora, 6 trips to the Stanley Cup Final for Peter Sikora. Won 2 Cups with the Devils in 2000, 2009. With the Pittsburgh Penguins.
All right, let's fill out those top 5.
All right.
Starting at number 5, who would you draft? 5th overall.
All right, 5th overall for me would be Mark Savard, who another guy that unfortunately injuries played a part in him, in his career. He really got going a little bit later in his career, originally drafted by the Rangers, but ended up having 2 90-point seasons. In 05-06, 97 points. 06-07, 96 points. Concussion problem slowed him down, but 0.875 points per game. That's pretty significant.
All right, Mark Savard at number 5. At number 4, who are you taking?
I'm going to go with the goaltender, Mika Kiprusoff. Ended up really with the bulk of his career with the Calgary Flames. He was drafted by the San Jose Sharks. And this was tough with 3 and 4 because you had a couple of goalies here. Kiprusoff, great during the regular season. 305 victories in his career, 41 shutouts in the postseason, 921 save percentage, helped the Flames to the Stanley Cup Final in 04, and really just some bad bounces in that series. Maybe the Flames could have come out on top.
Sounds like you're going back-to-back goalies.
Yes,
here.
I am. I am going back-to-back. I'm getting jiggy with it at number 3. J.S. Jagr is my number 3. And, you know, when you look at Jagr and you look at Kiprusoff, regular season, you'd probably say Kiprusoff is the better of the two goaltenders. But when you get in the postseason, J.S. Jagr had a 925 save percentage, a 2.08 goals against average, 6 shutouts. He won the Conn Smythe in 2003 and led the Ducks to a Stanley Cup in 2007. So that gives him a little bit of an edge for me. So I have Jiggy in there at number 3.
All right, another goalie at number 2. Where are you going?
Number 2, well, I think 1 and 2 are pretty easy to do in this draft. Number 2 is going to be Shane Doan. What a career he had. Over 1,500 games, 402 career goals. Just a legend for that Winnipeg Jets / Arizona Coyotes organization. And just kept getting it done year after year after year for the Coyotes. A great leader, so easy to have him as the number 2 pick in that draft.
Last but certainly not least, Who's the number one overall?
Yeah, number one is real easy. It's Jerome Iginla. I mean, over 1,500 games, 1,300 career points, won the Rocket Richard Trophy twice in his career, 02 and 04, the Lester Pearson Award, which is now the Ted Lindsay Award in 02, twice a 50-goal scorer, twice a 40-goal scorer, and just an amazing, amazing career for Jerome Iginla. So he'd be my guy at number one.
All right, outside of the top 10 back in 1995, going number one overall if EJ had to redraft today. Yeah. And Iginla, Hall of Fame eligible, coming up next year.
Both he and Shane Doan, Hall of Fame eligible. Iggy will be in. Shane, we'll have to see.